Lord, we're thankful for this morning, for Pastor Mike and for his family, Lord, and we just lift him up as he brings the word this morning. We just pray that you would open all our ears and our minds, Lord. Thank you again. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, beloved. Beautiful morning out there, and my prayer is that it'll be just as beautiful in here as we see the shining light of God's Word as being our the marker of our path the rest of this morning. I love the passage that Wade just read for us from Acts 26 because it's later on in Paul's life and in Paul's ministry, and he's standing before King Agrippa. King Agrippa has just, you know, heard Paul explain amazing things to him, and Agrippa's saying, "You mean you want me to become a Christian?" He's like, "Not only you, but everyone who can hear me." I mean, that is prototypical of what we know about Paul. I mean, Paul was saying, "Anyone that hears my voice can hear the good news of the gospel and respond to it. It doesn't have to be some king, and it doesn't have to be some person in high position and high authority, but everyone who can hear my voice, I want them to come to know the Savior." It's this universal application of the gospel of Jesus Christ that Paul is giving there. The reason why I chose that was for that, but also because Agrippa asks Paul in verse 28, he says, "In a short time, would you persuade me to be a Christian?" You want me to become somebody who is known as one of those people that's always proclaiming the name of Christ? These people that are saying they belong to Christ, you want me to become like him? Become like them? I'll say, yeah, short time or long time, whatever it takes, Lord, do it. Because it's not about Paul. And Paul was basically a big giant mirror reflecting Christ to King Agrippa and all who would hear him. He was moving this away from it being about himself to it being about the most important news that we could share, which is the good news of the gospel. So you may be asking then also, then what in the world does this have to do with Barnabas, who we've been talking about for a couple weeks? And if you want to flip back and have your Bibles open to Acts 11, you can do that now. You can put your bulletin there if you would like. Also, if you need a Bible, there are ESV Bibles on the back table as well. Either raise your hand and someone will bring one to you, or go ahead and grab one. But we invite you to see the Word of God for yourself as well, just so you know that what I'm saying is coming from the Word of God. So when we last left our good friend Barnabas, or the third Joseph of our series, he was being Saul's champion. This took place in Acts 9. And if you're unfamiliar with Saul and Paul, that's Paul is also called Saul. That would be his Jewish name. And he then later on, because he is a messenger to the Gentiles, starts to go by his name as it's pronounced in the Greek world, and which would be Paul. So don't let that confuse you when you hear Saul and Paul in this Testament. There is a different Saul, but that was many years ago in the Old Testament. So don't let that throw you off. But in Acts 9, we saw Barnabas being a champion for Saul. And I loved that text from Acts 9 from last week. And Barnabas was telling the other disciples in Jerusalem, those that had followed Christ throughout Christ's 3-year earthly ministry, that they no longer had to fear this Saul. And we saw that the reason why they had to fear Saul in the first place was because he was persecuting the church. He was chasing Christians. He was trying to get Christianity out of Jerusalem, much like the meeting that is going to take place next week. Paul, that you told us about. Not Saul, but this Paul here. Trying to get Christianity out. And it wasn't just merely playing with legal means and calling together superintendents or lawyers or mayors or governors. It was like, "I'm going to kill you, get you out of your Christianity." And Paul, or Saul, laid approval upon the death of Stephen as Stephen was professing Christ to the Jewish people, saying, "This is the Messiah you've been waiting for." And his pay for this preaching of the gospel was to be stoned to death, and those that stoned Stephen to death laid their coats, their garments, at the feet of Paul, so showing that Paul approved of this. That is why the Christian church was fearing this Saul or Paul. His reputation was far and wide. His territory that he was assigned to was everywhere the gospel was going. Everybody knew who Saul was. He was chasing the church. And then Barnabas steps in saying, this man is converted. Of course, the disciples were scared of him, but they respected Barnabas' discernment. He could see, he had spent time, obviously, with Saul, because he repeated Saul's testimony to the disciples, saying, this guy was confronted with the risen, living George, Jesus Christ, on the road to Damascus. He was blinded and then given sight. Blinded spiritually, given sight spiritually. And so that was where we left Barnabas. He was being a champion for Saul. The disciples feared that Barnabas was trying to bring the coyote into the hen house, bring the persecutor of Christians into the headquarters of Christianity. But Barnabas, our encourager and discerning friend, championed him. So last week, that is where we left off. The disciples were hypersensitive to Saul's reputation, and I think rightly so to some regards, and they did not welcome with open arms as Barnabas stood in his place. It took this Levite, because when we first met Barnabas, we learned that he was a Levite, which means in the Old Testament system, he had priestly duties. He either supported the priests, or he was actually a priest himself, depending upon which avenue of genealogy he would go back through into the Levite clan. So he either was a priest, or he supported the priest, but either way, he knew the law. He was one who was very familiar with the law, and now he himself is a Christian, probably because he saw this promise of the Messiah all along in Scripture and said, there he is. So it took this Levite to stand in the gap for Saul and to champion him. And that was Acts 9. This morning we're going to spend time in Acts 11, but before we get there, it's helpful for us to fly over chapter 10 to see what takes place, because it does actually have a bearing on our scene for us in Acts 11. I'm not going to read from Acts 10 directly, but let me just fly over to give you some details. So we left at Acts 9, and Saul was welcomed into Jerusalem. He starts preaching. He fears for his life. He is then sent off to Tarsus, which is 600 miles away from Jerusalem. That's a long ways away by foot. So he was relatively safe. They moved him off to Tarsus. And then Peter now starts to play a big role in Acts chapter 10. But first in Acts chapter 10, we learn of a man named Cornelius, who's a centurion of the Roman cohort in Caesarea, and he receives a vision from the Lord. So this man was not a Jewish person by lineage. He was a Gentile by lineage. But we also learn that he is a devout man who feared God. And God fears is the title given to non-Israelite descendants who are now following all the temple rules. There was God-fearers, there was a class of believers in the temple system of Judaism that were called God-fearers, and those would have been your non-Israelite people that are adhering to the Jewish law. That is pretty much what Acts 10 tells us about Cornelius. He receives a vision that he's supposed to summon this man named Peter, has no clue who he is, to his side, because Peter's got some news for him. Peter's vision, on the other hand, now is one of a sheep being brought down from heaven, and there's all these foods on it, and rise, Peter, eat. And there's food on there that's common and unclean according to the Jewish law. And God was giving this beautiful picture, the fact that what we called, or what the Jewish people called common and unclean, the Gentiles, Cornelius, don't call common or unclean is the Lord's message to Peter. So Peter, following the summons of the men of Cornelius, go to visit him. He shares with him the good news of the gospel, and we see that Cornelius is converted to Christ. He was ripe for the picking. He had followed the temple laws. He was familiar with the Jewish laws. He was familiar with the fact that there's this promised Messiah. Who is he? Peter comes and tells him who he is. All of a sudden, we have what many scholars call is the Gentile Pentecost. We know that when the Spirit descended upon those in Passover in Jerusalem, there was amazing gifts. People were talking in languages never known, that they had never studied. People are hearing the gospel. This was a Jewish Pentecost. And a lot of people call Acts 10 Gentile Pentecost. The Holy Spirit was now indwelling Gentiles. This is mind-boggling to the Jewish audience. We can hear it and kind of go, okay, yep, I get it. This is mind-boggling to the Jewish audience. This is the Gentiles are with us. We're co-heirs of grace in Christ. It's paradigm shifting. So that's what's going on in Acts 10. You've got the gospel now being spread to the Gentiles. The Gentiles are hearing and responding to the good news. We call it good news, but the church in Jerusalem, when Peter reports back about his activities with Cornelius, they weren't so happy. Because they had centuries and millennia of being separate, being set apart from the Gentiles. They were trying to be ceremonially clean. They can't hang out with them. Now they're like, Peter, what are you doing? You're going to the Gentiles? Apparently missing Jesus' lineage. Apparently missing the Abrahamic promise that Abraham would be a blessing to the nations, plural. And they're like, what are you doing, Peter? Peter explains what he's doing, and thankfully they come around and they just rejoice and say, well, apparently the gospel is spreading to the Gentiles. That's good news for you and me. I'm assuming all of us here are not of Israelite lineage. And we can say praise God for Jesus Christ. Acts 11:17 says, if then God gave the same gift to them, speaking of the Gentiles, as he gave to us when we believed in the Lord Jesus Christ, who was I that I could stand in God's way? And the disciples, when they heard Peter say that, when they heard these things, they fell silent. And they glorified God, saying, then to the Gentiles also God has granted repentance that leads to life. Amen, amen, and amen. So that is our story up until this beautiful scene that we'll start to look at in Acts 19. So please stand with me as we read from Acts 11, verses 19 just through 21, as we stand in honor of the Word of God, which offers salvation to Gentiles and Jews and to everyone who has ears to hear, including King Agrippa. Acts 11:19 reads, now those who were scattered because of the persecution that arose over Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, speaking the word to no one except Jews. Verse 20, but there were some of them, men of Cyprus and Cyrene, who in coming to Antioch spoke to the Hellenists, also preaching the Lord Jesus. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number who believed turned to the Lord. And this is his word. Heavenly Father, thank you for showing us and capturing in Scripture our spiritual forefathers. Father, not just because we see ourselves as Gentiles in the biblical sense, but Father, because we see that all along, Lord, you were planning this beautiful, epical moment. That, Father, that darkness that fell on the earth when Jesus died was now dawning forth a bright, shining light of this thing called the church and these people called Christians that now belong to Christ. Father, we praise you for your infinite wisdom and your foresight and in your plan in making this all a reality. We thank you for Jesus Christ. And Lord, may he be lifted high here this morning as we conduct the rest of our worship service to you, Lord. And it's in his precious name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. So that's the scene that's set up for us. This gospel has been spread, and it's going as far as Phoenicia, to Cyprus, to Antioch. It's going all over the place from Jerusalem. And it all because of the persecution that arose over Stephen. People are scattering. Like, it's just, what an amazing thing that God had foreordained and allowed to happen, that this word is going forth. I don't think that the missionaries in Jerusalem would have been like, quick, let's get out of here and spread the good news. It took some form of persecution for them to be pushed and urged to go, and maybe even unwillingly. Yet here they are. And the word is spreading to Cyprus and as far as Cyrene, Cyprus being an island just off of the Mediterranean, in the Mediterranean Sea, off of the coast. That's probably about 500 miles north of Jerusalem in the water. And so you've got this gospel being spread everywhere because these people are preaching the Lord Jesus. And it has spread all the way to Delton. We stand in that stream. Don't disconnect yourself from this historical reality. We stand in that stream. We are here today because of, first of all, what Jesus Christ did, but because of what happened in Acts 4 and in Acts 6 and in Acts 9. That's why we are here praising God together. So that is, first of all, hopefully that captures your attention that you are reading about your lineage. You have a history. Delton Community Church will be here. It will be around for 7 years this May, but Christianity has been around for, well, 2,000 years in formality, but since creation dawned. God knew this was going to happen. He promised to Adam and Eve that Eve's seed would crush the head of the serpent. That lying serpent, that father of lies that allows sin to creep into and invade beautiful and very good creation. So that's where we're at with this story. But when we last heard from Barnabas, he was still in Jerusalem. He had just stood for Saul. He said, brothers, this man is a brother. In fact, I've heard him preach. He's got a wonderful testimony. He's sharing the good news of Jesus Christ in a powerful way. And then, of course, they allow him to come in. Paul, Saul, is coming and going in Jerusalem. And then all of a sudden, the Jews are like, the ones that aren't yet following Christ are like, we got to get him now. The one who's getting the Christians is now on their side. Now we got to get him because he is powerful. So they send him off to Tarsus, but Barnabas was last left in Jerusalem. And we know that Barnabas is well known and well respected among the disciples in Jerusalem because they allowed his testimony for Saul to stand and for them to welcome him. So I believe that that's an important point for us. But what we also read a couple weeks ago is that because of Saul's approval of Stephen's death, that now invades today's story. Because if we were paying attention in verse 19 here, now those who were scattered because of the persecution that arose over Stephen, because of Saul, this gospel went forth. Because Saul approved of Stephen's death, many Christians were scattered throughout this vast region. Well, mostly to other Jews. That's the way it began. It started out as preaching to the Jews, and we even see that in this story, because they traveled as far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, speaking the word to no one except the Jews, which was, again, in God's divine plan. I love this detail, because remember, because of Saul, the Jews were being converted to saving faith in Jesus Christ. In far-flung places, hundreds of miles from Jerusalem, were hearing about Jesus, the promised Messiah, and they were being saved because of Saul. In fact, Saul's first missionary journey is probably sending these missionaries as he was persecuting the church. We may have our little maps in the back of our Bibles numbered wrong. That was his first missionary journey. Persecute Stephen. Church spreads. That's why Tertullian, in about the year 200, so you're talking 170 years approximately after Jesus' death, would say that the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. Because often it takes persecution to get us to go, to move out in faith, to be brave for our faith, to stand strong for our faith. It often takes that. And we see a beautiful example of that seed being spread by the blood of Stephen because of Saul or Paul's first missionary journey. So now there are these converted Jewish people. They're now trusting in Christ. They're all around this region. We've got them mentioned. But we have in 20 that there were some of them, men of Cyprus and Cyrene, were then coming to Antioch. Antioch, again, 500 miles north of Jerusalem. The island of Cyprus, just off of the coast, almost parallel with Antioch. So these men from this island of Antioch, where Barnabas is from, that's a pretty cool detail, and Cyrene. Scholars are split on whether Cyrene is just a reference for an actual city or if it's a reference to North Africans. They're not 100% sure. Whatever the case may be, you're talking far-flung places. We're going to Antioch and speaking to the Hellenists. Earlier that meant Greek-speaking Jews. Here, I think it means Greek-speaking Greeks, Gentiles. So they're preaching now to Gentiles, which is why we looked at Acts 10, because now the gospel is spreading to Gentiles in Antioch. And you say, why Antioch? Antioch was the third most important, the third largest city in the Roman Empire. That's a huge influence for the Gentile movement of the gospel in which you and I stand, in which this church stands. That is a huge influence. Very important city to Rome. The peace of Rome, Antioch would play a big role in maintaining that. And here we have them being converted to Jesus Christ as Lord, not ultimately to Rome. So I love that little detail. First of all, well, second of all, I also love the fact that some men, there's no names. So often we think that if we're going to be important in ministry, it's because we're going to make a name for ourselves. We're going to be known. People are going to hear about us, which could happen. God could allow that. We hear about Barnabas. We hear about Paul. We hear about all of our disciples. But here are some men. If eternity in heaven sounds like a long time, which is redundant because it is, just know that you will never tire from hearing stories, and you will meet these some men of Cyprus and Cyrene. You will meet them. I guarantee you the line at Barnabas' house is going to be long. I'll be in that line at some point. I'll be wanting to hear from Barnabas. Tell me your story again, Barnabas. I'll go to Saul's house. I'll want to hear from him. This is, of course, after spending time worshiping the risen Savior who gets all of the glory, by in front of whose throne Paul and Barnabas laid their crowns, because it wasn't for their own glory that they did what they did. But I can't wait to go to the house of the some men and hear about what they did in Antioch. Heaven is not going to be boring, first of all, because we'll spend our time in the glorified, risen presence of Jesus Christ. And if that isn't going to be enough, I mean, that's like a second shrimp cocktail on a cruise. If that isn't enough, you get to hear these stories of how men and women went all around the far-flung places without the aid of modern transportation, without cell phones, Facebook. They couldn't Facebook Messenger. Where are you at? I'm in Antioch. Well, be careful. It's very Roman there. They don't like Christianity and the Jews. They're not going to like you converting people. Okay, send, smiley face, thumbs up. None of that. They went walking 500 miles, 600 miles to share the good news of Jesus Christ. That is going to be cool. Some men of Cyprus and Cyrene, we will know them by name. And they'll say, I was just being a Christian because I belong to Christ. They're happy, I think. In fact, I almost think Barnabas would be a little bit embarrassed with all that we know about him. I think we know Saul. Paul would be too. He calls himself the chief of sinners. That's what he wants people to know about. I'm the chief of sinners. God rescued me. You have hope. The chief of sinners was saved. So some men of Cyprus and Cyrene, they came to Antioch and they started spreading the news to the Jews. They started preaching the Lord Jesus. That detail is quite important at the end of verse 20. And then 21, and the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number who believed turned to the Lord. We got repentance and faith, two sides of the same coin in action here. They turned from their pagan ways. They turned from their incomplete history of Judaism, which was without Christ, into the complete history of Judaism, which is with Christ fulfilling all of those promises, with him giving hope to the Gentiles, which is saying that the peace of Rome is violence in compared to the peace of Christ. I want to belong to Christ. And these people were being converted. And we see that the hand of the Lord was on them. We see this beautiful divine dance between the providential hand of the Lord, who doesn't has any shadow or casting or turning or changing and can see and know everything, in concert with the human actions of you and me. When you are engaged in evangelism, when you're engaged in sharing your faith with your loved ones, you're engaging with the hand of the Lord. I don't think I can do it. You're engaging with the hand of the Lord. What if they say a question I don't know an answer to? You're engaged with the hand of the Lord, which means he may give you an answer, he may not, and because sometimes that person needs to hear, let me get back to you. I'm a Christian, I don't know everything. I'm a pastor, I don't know everything, if that hasn't been imminently clear. You are engaging with, that shouldn't have got that wrong in the last hour. You are engaging with the hand of the Lord. Love that divine dance between our actions and God's sovereignty. God is so sovereign, he can use you in the actions of bringing other people to faith, including some men of Cyprus and Cyrene. Because the church in Antioch wasn't started by Paul or Barnabas. The big names. The guys know what the names on the top of the building. Barnabas and sons. Saul and Paul. No, it's just some men. So that's a beautiful, just in my opinion, that gives me relief. I can release the stress of, I'm going to do this wrong. Because God says, yep, but I got you. I can use your wrongness and your mistakes to still call people to the truth of Jesus Christ. Because Mike, it's not about you. It's about Jesus. So take comfort in that the hand of the Lord was with them. And because of that, a great number who believed, who had faith, turned. They repented and turned to the Lord. And verse 22. The report of this came to the ears of the church in Jerusalem. Barnabas is still in Jerusalem. So they send Barnabas to Antioch. Saul's in Tarsus, 600 miles away, only about 150 miles from Antioch. Barnabas is still in Jerusalem. They send him 500 miles north to check out Antioch. What is going on? News is coming that this thing Peter started, this Gentile Pentecost, where the good news is spreading to the Gentiles, they're falling underneath the conviction and the control of the Holy Spirit, is spreading. Now it's in Antioch, and there's a great number of people coming to Christ. Now I think they're actually not like Acts 10, where they're going, "What are you doing, Peter? This is our story." Now they're saying, "We got to send Barnabas." He was discerning. He actually knew that Saul was converted, and he said, "Welcome Saul in," and look at what an impact Saul had in Jerusalem. He was so strong in preaching that they wanted to kill him. Send Barnabas. He's discerning. Not only that, he's a Levite, he's a priest. So he'll be able to interact with these Jewish people that were part of this church. He'll be able to interact with them, but now he also will be able to interact and see the cutting edge of the gospel going forth into the Gentile land. So that's so cool. What that tells us about our Barnabas, our third Joseph, is so cool. So they send Barnabas this 500 miles up north to Antioch. Verse 23, when he, Barnabas, came and saw this humongous building, right? 23? When he came and saw these sharp-dressed people that had it all together, right? When he came and heard amazing music without a sour note played, right? That's what it says here. No, he saw the grace of God that uses sour notes, that uses bad preaching, that uses dirty clothes, that uses sinful people, that uses people that have been dragged and drugged through the mud of life. That's what he sees. He sees the grace of God lifting high people that are trusting in Jesus Christ. He doesn't see people that are all put together. He doesn't see a wax museum of Christianity. No, he sees a vibrant life of Gentiles and Jews mixing together, which normally would be like oil and water, and he sees the grace of God there in that place. That doesn't mean they had it all together. That doesn't mean they had it all figured out. That means they were just wanting to worship and to trust and to get to know this Christ that they were telling about. They didn't have Acts 11 to go to. Barnabas couldn't say, "Listen, guys, this is what's going to happen. See right here, the grace of God is with us." No, he was sharing with them what his testimony was. He was sharing with them what he knew about Saul, that this Saul guy was killing Christians, and now he's come to Christ. They knew who Saul was, more than likely, at least the Jews would have. So when Barnabas gets there, he sees the grace of God, and he was glad. Let the grace of God be a source of rejoicing for you. If you're involved in ministry of any kind, and you say to yourself, "I'm not," I'm going to say, check it again, because you are. You have family, you have friends. When you're involved in any ministry whatsoever, let the grace of God be a source of gladness for you. You'll get tired. You'll get worn out. Wednesday will come and you'll go, "God squad, I don't know, it's been a long week at work already." Let the grace of God that you see in those little lives as they repeat these beautiful verses and they start to know Him from their heart, let that grace of God bring you gladness. Let little victories bring you gladness. Don't expect an Antioch. That's not always going to happen. Let the grace of God bring you gladness, because that's what happened to Barnabas, and he is a son of encouragement, so he obviously knows whereof he speaks. So he was glad because of the grace of God, and then he exhorted them all to remain faithful to the Lord with steadfast purpose, lifting them up. Gentiles, you guys in Jews, you usually didn't mix too well. Stay not true to each other primarily, stay true to God, and because like the pianos, all 100 pianos tuned to the same fork, you will all strike the same note, whether you're Steinway or whatever we have. Steinbeck? No, that's an author. Steinway?
I don't know what it is.
Doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what brand of piano you are, Gentile or Jew, if you're tuned to Jesus Christ, you will all sing the same note, and you'll enjoy the company of the chords that you will make. Sour notes and all. So he's saying, remain true to the Lord, exhorting them to remain true to the Lord with steadfast purpose. Make that something that is your goal. I want to be clinging to Christ and to Christ alone. I want to belong to Christ. Using his name as Lord meant master, meant you are slave, servant to the one true God. And he's a loving master. And his yoke is light. And his correction is right. Who else better to belong to? The peace with God far supersedes the peace of Rome. that was superficial at best, and bought on the backs of slaves and in a different socioeconomic system. So here he says, love and exhort the God, remain true to him with steadfast purpose. Verse 24, we learned something really cool. This is like the quickest, this is like a Twitterable resume for Barnabas. For he was a good man, rightly understood, not perfect, but full of the Holy Spirit and faith. Faith just exuded out of Barnabas. He's full of the Holy Spirit, he's full of faith. And a great many people were added to the Lord. So this great church was becoming bigger. And another beautiful quality of Barnabas shows up in verse 25. He says, this church is getting way too big. We've got people who, Jewish people who probably get more of it than the Gentiles, because they got this background, this understanding of that this Messiah was going to come. They got this understanding that they lack righteousness and it's going to have to come from somebody. Then you've got the Gentiles who have no understanding of any of that. They've got an entirely pagan understanding. And Barnabas is saying, how can I do this, Lord? So there was an understanding, first of all, that Barnabas was humble. Sure, he knew a lot, but he also knew himself, and he knew that this was beyond his limits. So verse 25, Barnabas travels up to Tarsus to look for Saul. He makes that 150-mile journey up around the northern edge of the Mediterranean Sea to find Saul. He knew he was in Tarsus. Let me find this Saul. Pretty cool that he looked for him, huh? Do you remember how this church started? Because of Saul? He killed Stephen. People run. Church pops up. And now the one who started this all because of the killing of Stephen is here to now steward this church. That is a poetic masterpiece. And so when he found him, when Barnabas found Saul, he brought him to Antioch, and for a whole year they met with the church and taught a great many people. And in Antioch, the disciples were first called Christians. Saul, the persecutor of Christians, was now here lifting them up. The one who had been championed by Barnabas is now champion others. Never think that you are the end point. Tony, I'm going to tear up an electrical analogy. You're never the outlet at the end of the daisy chain. That's wrong too, like the pianos. You're never the final termination point of what God is doing. You're always in the line of the next person. That's what Paul and Saul and Barnabas, they're just doing this beautiful thing that we call Christianity. And in Antioch, the disciples were first called Christians. There are some scholars who would say that this is actually a derogatory term. I actually think, based upon the original languages, that that's more of a stretch, that's harder to prove than just understanding it as we do, which would say, you live in America, you are an American. Now, you are from Michigan, you're a Michigander. You know, that's kind of the way things work. And I can actually back that up with Scripture, because in Matthew, Mark, and Luke, those that were tied to Herod were called Herodians. And it wasn't a negative thing to Herod. It was, that's who we claim allegiance to. We talk so much about Herod, we're called Herodians. And I believe the same is true here, in that the way that this word works out in Greek, that this, they're just saying, these people talk so much about Christ, they're called Christians. Even if it's meant derogatorily, isn't that a compliment? So either way you look at it, it's still a compliment in my mind. They were so clinging to Christ, they knew the fact that they belonged to Christ, and that was their sole, main, primary identity, that they were known as Christians for the first time. So again, why we stand in the lineage of even this church in Antioch. What do you call yourselves? You call yourselves Christians, I pray, and I trust. That first happened because of what was going on in Antioch. These Gentiles, these Jews were coming together. Barnabas, the son of encouragement, our third Joseph, is coming there to encourage them, to strengthen them, to exhort them. He calls for Saul, the persecutor of the Christians, now a Christian, to come lift them up and to support them and to preach and to teach. That's strong lineage that we stand in here. And I think it's a wonderful nickname, if it's a nickname at all, that they get to be called Christians. All because Barnabas was full of the Holy Spirit. Saul, in his true conversion, resulted in him being brought into this thing called the church, and they're first called Christians. Barnabas was a Levite, and he was intimately familiar with priestly duties and Jewish life. Saul, or Paul as we know him now, was a Pharisee of Pharisees, intimately familiar with Jewish life, violently opposed to Christianity. Barnabas was likely converted upon the death of Jesus and the subsequent events. He was probably in Jerusalem at Jesus' death and the first Pentecost, and Saul was converted by that blinding light on the road to Damascus while hunting Christians. You and I likely fall somewhere in the middle. Were we violently opposed to Christianity, or we were somewhat familiar with it? But both Barnabas and Saul, upon conversion, devoted themselves to Christ. They now belonged to Christ. And they made progress in the faith under teaching and devotion to worship of Jesus. God very likely isn't calling every single one in here to be a Barnabas directly. I think we all should have that element of encouragement and encouraging one another, because this thing called Christianity can be quite difficult at times, either from infighting or from pressures from the outside. But we should all have that element of being an encourager to others. I don't even think that we're all called to be missionaries in the sense that we drop everything and we go wherever God has called us to, because he can call you to be a faithful missionary where you are, in your own circles of influence, work, family, in your neighborhood, in the grocery store, at the bank if you don't do that on your phone. But why not today commit to making Christ more visible in your daily life? And that's not calling you to do anything externally false or anything contrary to Scripture, because we're called to follow Christ more and more every day. The Holy Spirit is indwelling us to call us to be more like Christ each and every day. That's why we're being conformed into his image daily. That we die to ourselves, we die to our desires, our fleshly desires that want to pull us away from Christ, and we're alive to new life in Christ. And we want to be in concert with this Christ with whom we are now saved and with whom we now, or to whom we now belong. So why not meet Christ every morning in his word or in prayer? And if morning is not your time, why not in the afternoon? If afternoon isn't your time, why not at night? Kind of get where I'm going with that. We're not all morning people, but we're all something people. Find that time that works for you and meet with him. Why not let people know that you belong to Christ? Well, they might look at me funny. They might treat me differently. I might get passed over for that promotion. I might get pressure from parents that are going to call the superintendent. But why not let Christianity be your primary identity? In Antioch, God was building an embassy to the kingdom of God so that he had ambassadors within that embassy that would represent him in that Antiochian community. In Delton, he's building an embassy of God in Delton Community Church and in Faith United Methodist Church and in Interlakes Baptist Church and in Doster Reformed Church. He's building embassies. Why not us be ambassadors and reflect him and represent him well in the community and to speak the truth in love? To be brave and bold for Jesus Christ and laying aside our reputation and even our advancements at work. Because even if your faith requires your life, that is still underneath the banner of Christ. When we come to him, we surrender all, the hymn says. I surrender all. It's all on the table. How about we become even more and more known as those that belong to Christ. More and more as Christians, maybe rescue that word in your own spheres of influence and reflect him well. And to do so not for your own glory, but for the glory of God alone. Staying in the book of Acts, just like in Antioch where they were devoted to the apostles' teachings, Acts 2:42 tells us that that church in Jerusalem, the first church, was actually committed to a number of things. The apostles' teaching, fellowship with one another, prayers, and also the breaking of bread, to use them out of order. As a church, we can demonstrate that we corporately belong to Christ as well. This morning, we've done a number of those things. We've looked at the apostles' teachings. We've had fellowship with one another. We've shared with each other praises and prayer concerns. We've prayed together. I'm sure we've prayed individually and silently as well. But we also get to break bread together as the church. And in doing so, we're remembering the one to whom we belong. because we belong to Christ. By breaking bread together, we're saying that we're part of this thing called Christianity. You're known as a Christian because of who Christ is, and you're also part of this thing called a family, the one another's of Scripture. But I think we're also saying that our sustenance, our very survival, belongs entirely in the hands of God. We're pulling in something foreign to us. We're taking bread and wine to represent Jesus' body and blood. Because we don't have a righteousness of our own to speak of. There's not a single person in here, no matter how socially good you've been, that can stand before God and Him look at you and say, "That's good enough, come on in." All of us need an advocate. All of us need a Barnabas to stand for us. And we have the great true advocate in Jesus Christ, like we talked about last week from 1 John 2:1, that He is our advocate and He stands for you. So therefore, as we remember His death and resurrection in this Lord's Supper, we're also recognizing that we're taking in something that's foreign to us, an alien righteousness, if you will. This is a great picture of that. It's the bread, the body of Christ, which stands for us. His body of perfect righteousness and law-keeping and sinlessness stands for you, and He gives you an alien foreign righteousness. So if you're standing here this morning, you're thinking, "I don't have anything to bring before Him," or even if maybe you're prideful and you say, "I'm not bad enough," God is saying, no, Christ is who stands for you. He can save Paul, and He can save Barnabas, and everyone in between. So when we take this bread, and when we drink from this cup, we're doing that to recognize that we're reliant upon God for our everything, and that God is one who stands for us, and that in His death He did, and we remember that. And Paul would later, after these amazing times with Barnabas and throughout his missionary journeys, would actually give us a great teaching on that. And this is found in 1 Corinthians 11. 1 Corinthians 11, 17. Paul's talking to this church, which is having problems. There's divisions, and he says in verse 17, "But in the following instructions, I do not commend you, because when you come together," when they were practicing the Lord's Supper, "you didn't do it for better, but for the worse. For in the first place, when you come together as a church, I hear that there are divisions among you, and I believe it in part. For there must be factions among you in order that those who are genuine among you may be recognized." Verse 20, "When you come together," it's not the Lord's Supper that you eat. You can call it the Lord's Supper, but that's not where your heart is. Verse 21, "For in eating, each one goes ahead with his own meal." It's not Christianity, putting yourself first. "Each one goes ahead with his own meal. One goes hungry and another gets drunk." Verse 22, "What? Do you not have houses to eat in and to drink in? Or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What shall I say to you? Shall I commend you in this? No, I will not." Now he provides the correction that I think it's helpful for us to always, or from time to time, to take these instructions in that light. Verse 23, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me.'" And Paul continues in verse 26 after finishing that quote from Jesus. He says, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." That's what we are going to do this morning. We're going to proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. To be honest with you, I actually hope we don't get to the Lord's Supper. I hope he comes before.